This video is designed to better inform you about naval radio and radar emission hazards to personnel and the safety measures in place to protect personnel. Radios and radars send out invisible electromagnetic energy waves. The energy used by radios and radars occurs in the non-ionizing range. If someone is too close to the source, it can be felt as heat or tingling of the skin, although the effects are normally gradual and short-term. When higher energy is applied, it is called ionizing energy, as in the case of X-rays. Ionizing energy can cause serious health concerns, but this is not the type emitted by radios and radars. Research shows us that when a human body is at rest, the maximum energy it can receive before the physical effects become evident is 4 watts per kilogram of body weight. At this point, it has been estimated that skin will experience a temperature increase of 1 degree Celsius over a 15-minute period. This is defined as the maximum specific absorption rate, and this heating effect is the most obvious indicator of overexposure. From cell phones to laptops, radio waves are all around us all the time. A naval vessel is one of the biggest platforms for radio and radar transmitters. Radar is needed for navigation and, as well, to see incoming threats. When a ship is at sea and is looking for threats, there is a constant flow of radio signals to keep the ship safe and engaged. But ships do not operate these systems the same way when alongside. Radios are still used, but at far less power. When the equipment needs to be maintained and tested, this is when it needs to be turned on alongside. This is when extra safety measures are applied. Health Canada is the regulating authority for radio frequency hazards. They have published a standard called Safety Code 6 for radio frequency safety, and the RCN complies with it. Safety Code 6 defines 2 safety categories for personnel to be around radio frequency transmitters, from cell phone towers to radars. A controlled environment standard is set as the recommended physical distance from the transmitter, having a safety factor of 10, where the specific absorption rate would be no greater than 0.4 watts per kilogram of body mass. To apply this controlled environment and allow personnel to work to this standard, the following 3 conditions must be satisfied. 1. The energy from the emitters must be known. This is confirmed through physical surveys using test equipment or through high-tech modeling. 2. People must be made aware that they will be working in a controlled environment beforehand, including the source of the energy and where the safety zones exist. 3. People working in a controlled environment zone must be aware of the health risks and can apply mitigations if they are experiencing adverse effects. These conditions are met in naval ships. By current DND policy, all RF emitters are surveyed upon ship initial delivery, and then every 3 years thereafter. Ships also have strict internal procedures to control access to the upper deck areas where the antennas are located. And all work requires an onboard supervisor to brief visiting personnel on the hazards and the safety restrictions in effect. However, under Safety Code 6, where these conditions cannot be assured, a safety factor of 50 has to be applied, and this limits the maximum specific absorption rate to 0.08 watts per kilogram or less. This is known as the uncontrolled environment safety distance, and is commonly seen by fences at unmanned transmitter towers. Navy life is a dangerous business. Personnel take safety very seriously. When it comes to RF equipment alongside, crews shut down unnecessary equipment, and this equipment is locked up every day. They apply strict lockout-tagout protocols to power supplies to ensure nothing gets turned on when personnel are working on the equipment. A special form has to be filled out whenever there is work being done in the upper areas of the ship where RF emitters are located. It is a checklist, and it is a record of all hazards and precautions taken. Every job has a ship supervisor that is connected to all the other jobs going on to coordinate the work and control access throughout the ship. The officer of the day coordinates all operations on board on behalf of the commanding officer, which includes ensuring the safety measures are applied by the various departments on board. The regular RF energy surveys of RCN equipment determine both controlled and uncontrolled environment safety distances and areas where these maximum exposure limits are reached. To ensure maximum safety, the RCN has been applying the uncontrolled environment restrictions around RF transmitters and ship upper deck areas. In so doing, movement on upper decks when RF equipment was operating was often restricted, forcing delays in many ship operations. When personnel are aware of RF transmitters emitting, ships can apply reduced safety distances and remove many upper deck restrictions. This opens up access to many parts of the ship and improves overall productivity both ashore and at sea, and it's still safe for everyone. The management of radio frequency hazards in the RCN starts right from federal legislation. Directives managed by the DND RF Safety Technical Authority define what needs to be done on DND equipment to define safe working distances and safe zones. They also monitor incidents to ensure their directives are working. Assistant Deputy Minister Materiel, or ADM MAT, is the authority for the DND RF Safety Program. ADM MAT has assigned its Quality Engineering and Test Establishment, QETE, an organization within ADM MAT, as its RF Safety Technical Authority. QETE models new equipment RF energy levels to establish initial safety distances. QETE conducts surveys on all RF equipment to confirm safety distances and safety zones. And QETE is advised of all RF incidents and monitors trends and corrective measures by users. The RCN has developed internal directives to comply with DND policy and federal regulations. As part of the RCN safety and environmental management system, ship RF emitters are surveyed for RF energy as part of its initial acquisition to confirm maximum exposure limits and define safety boundaries. This survey is repeated every 3 years thereafter to confirm these findings. These safety distances and restricted areas are posted for all ship RF equipment. All incidents are investigated for health impacts to personnel and reported to QETE. Ships are inspected for conformance to these procedures, and these procedures are reviewed annually. As part of the special instructions in the Man Aloft form, job supervisors must advise and coordinate with adjacent ships and local crane operations when certain RF equipment must be operated. This is verified by the officer of the day. Ships fly certain flags as visual indicators to other ships and to people ashore of man aloft work, RF transmissions, and radar dish rotation. Many transmitters, especially radars, have controls imposed to restrict the direction of transmission away from shore towards open water for tests and trials. When these flags are flown from ships, they are a visible signal to other ships and those ashore. Flag Kilo indicates personnel are working aloft. Flag Lima means that the ship is transmitting, and Flag Echo indicates that a transmitter, usually a radar dish, is physically rotating but not necessarily transmitting. Keep in mind that these are information signals. They are intended to remind people working aloft in the area to ask if they are unsure. Modern radars can also physically control the direction of RF transmission. When equipment tests need to be done, procedures not only require ships to direct away from shore, but also impose buffers to further reduce the potential for transmission near personnel. All transmitters have locks, not only for their power supply, but to those using a rotating dish. These locks are kept in a master keyboard when alongside, and standard lockout-tagout protocols are applied for any aloft work. Not only do the workers control the keyboard, but there is a visible map that illustrates what locks control what emitters, and color-coded tags are used to more easily recognize the type of restrictions in effect. Not all ship keyboards are the same, but they serve the same purpose: to prevent unauthorized RF transmissions, especially when personnel are aloft. Signs are used to identify restricted areas due to RF. Both fixed and portable signs, combined with barriers, are used throughout the ship to keep people outside the designated restricted zones or keep them from lingering. When work aloft is performed, an initial and daily briefing are performed by the onboard job supervisor to advise workers of the hazards and restrictions, including the hazards from adjacent ships that could impact personnel and their activities on board. All this information is contained in the Man Aloft Work Authorization Forms. A D&D 2145 Man Aloft Work Authorization Form is required for all aloft work. It is a checklist that confirms that all the safety steps are followed and records the acknowledgement by everyone involved, from the officer of the day, the ship's staff supervisor, to the personnel doing the work. The Navy recognizes this as a legitimate safety risk to its own personnel as well, and insists that all ship's personnel are trained in the hazard and the mitigations. All ship's personnel are required to receive annual RF safety training as part of its mandatory combat readiness requirements. This training and its application are verified by Sea Training's combat readiness evaluations. Conformance to these safety rules is also verified by Formation RF safety officers. These conformance inspections are done in all ships on a 3-year cycle. It also provides critical information for continual improvement. So the risk of RF overexposure by being too close to an active RF transmitter is considered very low. But even after all these precautions, if someone experiences a sudden tingling and warming effect to their skin while working near a transmitter, it's not a panic. The effects are noticeable but gradual. They should leave the area immediately and advise their supervisors. If on a ship, they should try to contact the ship's work supervisor so that an investigation can be conducted. For any suspected injury, an individual should confirm with the dockyard first aid attendant. If there still remains any doubt over the seriousness of the injury, the individual should see a physician. Every suspected overexposure incident needs to be confirmed. Where the source is believed to be from a ship, the ship's staff and the supervisor of the affected employee both have to be involved. A request for incident investigation must be raised by the employee's supervisor, and the ship is required to return the results of that investigation. If confirmed, an RF incident report is raised by the ship with a copy to the supervisor's unit. For confirmed incidents, the employee needs to raise a DND 663 hazardous occurrence report. This will ensure a permanent record will exist. Not all incidents are a result of overexposure. Breaches of procedure are also reported as an RF incident. If someone is working to the controlled environment standard, but it was not authorized, this breach in policy is still reported, even though the RF exposure received is not considered a health threat. The Navy treats RF safety seriously, and this is just another way in which it demonstrates it. As part of its safety policy, the Royal Canadian Navy reviews the effectiveness of its RF safety program annually. As part of its commitment to continual improvement, all incidents and inspection reports are reviewed to determine if new trends are emerging that require more attention or improved administrative or physical safety measures. Representatives from the formations, the fleet, and NDHQ convene to review and discuss the effectiveness of current procedures and consider updates to training, equipment, and procedures to help prevent these incidents from recurring. The Royal Canadian Navy complies with federal radio frequency safety regulations. The regulations have two safety categories called controlled environment and uncontrolled environment. Both these categories are safe, but because the controlled environment standard has shorter safety distances, people working in these areas need to be aware of the sources of RF energy, the applicable safety restrictions, and an appreciation of the indicators of overexposure beforehand. The benefit of working at a controlled environment is the reduction in restrictions on upper decks and adjacent areas, and this simply makes working on a ship easier for everyone. The Navy has a long history of successfully managing radio frequency hazards. We sincerely hope that this video demonstrates how this has been achieved and that it will help to assure you of this continued commitment to personnel safety.